Good morning and happy Sabbath, church family. Please join us as we worship our Most High and flood the gates of heaven with our songs of praise. Please stand and sing with us.
Number one, we have a youth edition, Your Questions Answered at 2 p.m. What did I say? at 2 p.m. Join us after potluck here in the sanctuary. We're going to have a Your Questions Answered Youth Edition. We are going to answer all the questions from the age bracket 10 to 25. So any youth, anybody in that age range, you are more welcome to join as we answer the questions that you have been, answer the questions you have been asking. And not only that, we're going to have a special guest. We're going to have a special guest, and her name is Melody Jardinico. Is she here? They're lost. They'll be here later. But we're going to have a special guest. Her name is Melody Jardinico. She is a bright young 13-year-old who has a passion for ministry, has a passion for sharing the truth. She's going to share her story, and she's going to share a message why young people are leaving the church. Very important topic, especially for us today. So she's going to share the message, why people are leaving the church, and then right after that, we're going to have a panel discussion on Your Questions Answered. So that's happening at what time? 2 p.m. All right, awesome. Number two, the second announcement is that tomorrow here starting at 1 p.m. to 4, the Pathfinders are going to have a fundraising event. They're going to have an ice cream social. How many of you like ice cream? I just had ice cream at Overwise yesterday. It was amazing. And I'm sure my son will be there because he loves ice cream. So if you love ice cream like my son Kai, come join us. We're going to have an ice cream social. There's going to be games for the kids. And all of it will help continue to fund our Pathfinding ministry here at Hinsdale, Fil-Am. So join us Sunday, 1 p.m. to 4 in the parking lot. And then our third announcement is this. On September 4, we are going to have a family fun run, a 5K for our church. How many of you like running? How many of you like walking? How many of you like just staying put? Well, we believe in the health message. We believe that you should be active, you should be fit, you should get your cardio moving so you can have a good heart. So on September 4 at 8:30 a.m. here in the parking lot, we're going to have a 5K. Bring your friends, bring your family, bring your dogs. I'm going to go ahead and bring my dog too. So join us. We're going to have a 5K. If you want to run, run. If you want to walk, or if maybe you want to just enjoy the outdoors with us, just join us. Hinsdale Fil-Am Family Fun Run 5K on September 4th. And if you want to have more information during the week, and if you want to continue to be in the know of what's happening here in the church, did you guys know we have a newsletter? It's called Church Notes. We send it every Wednesday or Thursday, all the announcements, even a message preview of what to know and what to expect every Sabbath. So if you want to be a part of this Church Notes, come talk to me. I'll get your email and we'll put you up on the signing sheet so that you could be in the know every week in your email, all the information you need to know about what's happening in this church. I have two more final announcements that I want to share with you. Rochelle has, we all know Rochelle, she's part of our church family here. Next Sabbath in Washington, they are going to have a memorial service. Now, I know many people may not be able to go to Washington to attend. So, on September 17, they are going to have a memorial service for Rochelle here in this church. So, more information to come. It's going to happen September 17 here at this church to give memory to Rochelle. And then finally, we just heard news of our dear friends and our family here in this church. Martha Kendall has passed away. It's sad to know that one of our good friends has passed. But it's good to know that we don't sorrow like how the world sorrows. We're able to know that there is a resurrection. Amen? That though things may happen in this world, though we may cry, though we may be hurting, we know that God is going to right all of us. So we just want to announce to our church family that Martha Kendall has passed away. So we just want to ask you guys to keep their family in prayer. Let them know that you're there for them. And in this time of grieving, that our church family can surround them. So thank you for joining us in our worship. We're going to continue on. We're going to have our children come up. So all the children, let's come up for children's story. And Uncle Rodney has a message for you. So come on up. Children, come on up. This is your time to know more about Jesus. Let's come on up for our Lamb's Corner.
Okay, happy Sabbath, kids. Can you say happy Sabbath for me? Happy Sabbath. Can you say it loud? Happy Sabbath. Now, there is a beautiful island called Hawaii. How many of you have been to Hawaii before? It's a beautiful island. How many of you been there? I don't think anyone has been there. Church, have you been to Hawaii before? Beautiful, right? So, when they first discovered the island, they had divers explore the reefs. How many of you like to swim? Anyone like to swim? Yeah. Kai, do you like to swim? Yeah, I know you do. I know you love to swim. So there is this one diver, we'll call him Scuba Steve. Can you say Scuba Steve? Scuba Steve. He was exploring the reefs. He got his fins. I have my fins right here. He put on his fins. And then he also put on his goggles. And then he also put on his hand fins. And he was ready to swim. Do you guys like swimming? So he has his fins and his goggles.
Okay.
So he goes down into the reef and he starts swimming. Can you show me swimming? He's swimming around, going into the reef, and then he saw a large fish. Show me a very scared face. Scary. A large fish. He went up, took a deep breath, and went back down to see the fish. And he noticed something was different. It wasn't a large fish anymore, but a small fish. He looked closer, swam closer to the fish, and then it became a big fish again. And he found out it wasn't a big fish at all. It was actually a school of fishies. How many of you like fishies? Do you like to eat fish? Do you have a pet fish? No pet fish? Just for food? Okay. So he swam closer and he realized that it was a school of fish. It wasn't a large fish at all, but it was actually small fishies grouped together swimming. And so he learned a very important thing about this fish, that when it was in danger, to protect themselves from all the predators that might eat them, they united together to appear large. So go ahead and look at the screen. I'm going to show you a large group of fish that bands together, unites together, and becomes a big, large ball of mass. Go look at the screen. Look behind you. Wow, isn't that amazing? Look. Big fish. So what they do, all the fish comes together to make it look like they're really big, so it intimidates and scares all the sharks and all the big fish that might want to eat them. So here's the lesson I want you guys to learn. Hi. Here's the lesson. Are you guys ready? Repeat after me. When we are united, say it again. When we are united, we thrive. Okay, say it louder. When we are united, we thrive. So the fishies come together, they unite, and they can protect themselves, and they are able to grow bigger because nobody is going to eat them. So when we are united, we thrive. Let's pray. Dear Jesus, thank you, Father, for this message. Help us to learn from these fishies that when we are united together in one purpose and one goal, we are able to thrive and grow. Be with all the children today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you, kids. Now is our time for our faithfulness and gratitude. And I want to just share with you, the reason why we give is for this specific reason. And it is found in 1 John. It says, we love him because he first loved us. What is amazing is that when we give in our tithes and offering, we give back to the one who created us. In Genesis 1, it says, in the beginning, God. In the beginning, God. We serve a God who was there from the very beginning, who created the heavens and the universe. And then by the simple gesture of giving our tithes and offerings as the deacons come out, as you give of your tithes and offerings, let us always remember that we serve a great God. We serve a loving God. And that by giving your tithes and all the offerings, it will help not only you understanding that everything good comes from him, but it also helps in terms of bringing forth the mission and the gospel to our community. So as the deacons come by, give of your tithes and offerings.
Morning, happy Sabbath. For those of you who are able, if you'll kneel with me as we pray. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we come again to speak to you corporately, together as a church family, to seek you and to see your grace and to see your love. Dear Lord, we praise you this morning for all the miracles you have done in our lives. There are miracles that are clearly seen and those that we will never see or come to realize until that day when we meet together to be together forever. Lord, we know that day is coming soon. You told us, yes, I am coming soon. Lord, it's so easy to praise you for all the good things that have happened in our lives. But this morning, we want to praise you for all of the trials and tribulations that have been set forth in our lives. During trials of sickness, remind us to pray. Help us during those times to get even closer to those whom we love. During trials of sorrow, when someone close passes away, these are the most difficult times for us as humans. But as disciples of your love, help these moments to be beacons of light to show the world how much you love us. And that remembering that those who love the Lord, all things joyful and sorrowful, work for good. We pray for the Consignado family. We pray for the Richardson family. We pray for the Kendall family. We pray for all the families going through difficult times, and we ask for strength and peace. May they feel the peace that only is experienced through your presence. Let us remember that the death of your son is the most glorious event in the history of the world and the greatest display of your love for the world. Dear Lord, we ask this morning to be with your servants, Pastor Nestor and Katherine, as they deliver the word to us through a discussion and through answering questions. Speak to us through them and touch our hearts and minds. We ask all of this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Continue to join your worship and praise as we sing these next couple of songs.
Jesus is mine.
Blessed Lord, to the cross where
you hear me okay? There we go. Happy Sabbath. As you know, I'm not alone up here. I have someone I call my better half here. Want to say anything, Katherine?
Hi. It's good to be up here.
Your mic on?
Oh, no. It's not. Hello.
Can you hear me?
There you go. So
it's
we are here.
What'd you say? Here. It's a different view.
Yeah,
from up
first
here.
Time up here. So you might be wondering, what are we doing? Those of you who are new here or visiting, we welcome you here. By the way, if you're here, there's a potluck afterward. Join us for some great food. We are in a series right now entitled "Your Questions Answered." We are seeking to answer as many questions as we can. Now we've received over 50 questions, and they're all over the map. And this is a 5-week series. We finished last week, session 3. Today, we are grouping all of the relationship questions together. And so everything about relationships we put into today. And so that's why Katherine and I, the experts in marriage who have been married for 9 years.
Only.
We're not. Trust me, we don't call ourselves experts. We want to share things from our experience, but there are people here who have been married longer and much more qualified.
We might know what not to do.
That's true.
So we'll share what we know, but we're by no means experts.
That's true. And in case you were wondering, hey, we don't have enough time to cover all the questions here, or maybe you asked a question that wasn't answered, we're going to do a series starting on September 17, a 7-week series called Relationship Status, where we're going to cover dating to marriage and everything in between. So that's a 7-part series. So we're going to cover relationships in more detail starting September 17. But today we're going to talk about relationships. Now, if you do have any more questions, we have one more week next week where one of our elders, Bing Alabada, and Pastor Rodney will be covering Bible questions. So use your phone, scan that QR code, put your questions in. We'd love to hear from you if you do have a question. Before we start, let me just share a few comments based on feedback. I've been asking different people at our board, members, leaders, hey, how do you think this whole question and answer format has been going? And this is my first time doing something like this. One person was sharing that I wish that these questions or the answers were more exhaustive. We've covered some pretty tough topics the last few weeks, and I just want to tell you that we have limited time. There's only so much that we can answer, and what we're trying to do is we're trying to teach principles, not particulars. And so we actually expect you to take the information today and have discussions at home. I know several families, they'll take the content and the teaching today in weeks like this, and they'll discuss them at home. So go ahead and do that. And there might be something that we say that you might disagree with. It's okay. It's okay to disagree with us. And the reality is that Katherine and I, we don't claim to know it all, and we don't claim that we are always right. So we might be wrong. Talk to us. We can have a respectful conversation and don't have to put up a wall between us. So one, there was a feedback, I wish we were more exhaustive. That's one response. And secondly, I also heard this response. One said, I wish Pastor and the panelists, you were a little bit more direct, especially with some of the hot topics. And I do want to say, if you want to know what we believe, I mean, you know, the pastoral team, at least the panelists, we hold to a traditional view and if you want to look to what we believe as a worldwide church here in this community of faith, look at the Seventh-day Adventist official statements and you can see. Let me share this with you. Many of you are interacting with people who are non-Christians in school and at work. And what we're trying to do as panelists is we're trying to model how to actually have conversations in a volatile culture. And so, personally, I don't find it helpful for us to come from a greater than thou attitude, but to have a conversation and to put things on the table and have discussions based on differences of beliefs. So those are just a few notes I wanted to share. We're going to try to fly through. We have lots of questions about relationships here. We're going to spend more time on the substantial questions. So let's get right to it.
All right.
Let's do it. Relationship questions. All right. First, Katherine, what is the most joyful part of marriage? I'm paying attention.
In 30 seconds? I think the most joyful part is just doing life together. Having someone to go through life with, the bad, the good, the ugly. And for someone to know me, like all of those stuff, the good and the bad, and still love me, that's a good feeling. To be fully known and fully loved, that's amazing.
I love that. And I love you.
What about you?
The word that, when we were talking about this, the word that came to mind, just speaking about our marriage, married 9 years, dated 3 years? It's a long time.
I think so, yeah, 3.5.
So we've known each other, what, 13, 14, 15 years, something like that. Mm-hmm. The word that came to my mind when I was thinking about the answer is the word synergy. Can you say synergy with me?
Synergy.
Do you know what synergy is? Synergy is when you take several people. It's like when you're on a team, basketball team, you take 5 players, and you work toward the same goal, which is to defend and to score as many points as possible. So what's awesome about marriage is that we have synergy in all areas of our lives, from parenting, disagreements, you know, we work through things, the type of food that we like to eat when we go out to eat, we love Asian food, to the conversations that we have, the synergy that we have with similar beliefs. I mean, that's huge. To have the same values and to be able to talk at night about those same values, our religious beliefs, our beliefs about the world, our beliefs about people. So when you take all of these dimensions of life and we're all in harmony or working together, that's called synergy. And I believe that that is what is demonstrated by the Imago Dei. I mentioned the Imago Dei last week, which is a Latin word for the image of God. We all were created in God's image, right? God said, let us make man in our image. And he made man and woman. And we reflect that image. And if you look at the God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit, I mean, you talk about synergy, they move and think and talk and converse and dream and laugh and cry together, all together with great synergy and intimacy. And so I think that that's really the best picture of the best picture of marriage and the most joyful part of marriage.
I agree. So what is the most difficult part of marriage, though? Or of being married to me?
Yeah. The most difficult part of marriage is admitting that I'm wrong.
Hmm.
So let me just put it this way. The hardest part about marriage is learning how to fight well.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? I call this conflict control. Many of us, we're good at conflict, but we're not good at controlling the conflict that's raging inside, right? And I believe that it's just learning how to disagree well and to separate the issue from the person.
Mm-hmm.
Right, so that when Catherine's saying, hey, you know, you said you were gonna do this and this and this with these chores, I'm separating the issue from myself. So I'm thinking to myself, you know, I'm not trying to put my barrier up and my shield because she's attacking me. Mm-hmm. She's actually talking about an issue, and it's me humbling myself enough to say, you know what, is there anything true about what Catherine's saying right now? That's hard. And I have to humble myself enough to be able to do that.
Yeah. I think for me, the most difficult part of marriage changes depending on what life stage I'm in. So yeah, in the early years, it used to be how to figure out how to talk to each other and how to fight well. And I think after 9 years, I think we've gotten better at fighting, don't you think?
I think so.
Because we don't assume bad motives anymore, and we put True. Each other's best interest in mind. And so it's gotten easier. But I think for now, at this stage of life, the most difficult part is finding time for each other, like us as a couple. Because a lot of things in our life require our time. Our kids, our work, we both work. We're also son and daughter, and we're brother and sister to siblings. So a lot of things require our time. So it's definitely hard to find time for each other. We try, but yeah, it is difficult sometimes.
There are times where, you know, I've learned, you know, in the beginning, it's explosive, like, hey, you know, trying to figure out this, like, how to fight well, right? We're not talking about physical fights here, okay, guys? We're talking about having disagreements and arguing, right? But now there are times where, you know what? If we have a disagreement, right now I have to say, I'm not ready to talk about that right now. And I just have to give myself a time out to enter the conversation again. Yeah. Anything else you want to share?
No, I think that's it.
Sounds good.
Let's move on because we have a lot of questions.
All right.
There's a lot of questions in this topic, so I'll read the first one. Why does Paul advocate being single as a gift from God in 1 Corinthians 7:7, while God created men and women to be together?
All right, so why does Paul advocate being single as a gift? I remember I had a roommate at the University of Wisconsin. We met in Madison, and I was the pastor there in Madison East Church. And he was late 20s, getting into his 30s. And I said, Jared, I think you have the gift of singleness. And he said, I reject that. He would always tease me. But let's just read what the text says, okay? 1 Corinthians chapter 7, verse 7. So here's Paul talking. He says in verse 7, I wish that all men were as I am, meaning single. But each man has his own gift from God. One has this gift, another has that. So that's where the question is coming from. Let me just share this with you, okay? I believe that Christianity doesn't elevate marriage over singleness. In fact, Christianity elevates marriage and it elevates singleness. So let me ask you this. What is the purpose of marriage? What do you think? And you can talk about this when you get home with your families over potluck. What is the purpose of marriage, right? So in today's culture, I remember in the 1990s, the 1990s were the era of slow jams. Do you guys remember the slow jams? Casey and JoJo, All My Life, Boys to Men, NSYNC, Backstreet Boys, mm-hmm. Tony Rich Project, right? So all of these love songs would elevate the emotional, right? The it's all about my happiness and I will jump off the highest cliff for you, right? Because the epitome of joy is romance. According to the Christian worldview, the primary purpose of marriage is not happiness. I mean, we do get happiness. The primary purpose of marriage is to build up God's image. It's to build God's kingdom. God said, let us make man in our image. They made Adam and Eve. God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit were already perfectly happy, but they decided to make Adam and Eve to extend that happiness, to extend the kingdom of happiness. And so the purpose of marriage is not happiness. The purpose of marriage is to be a part of God's mission, which gives happiness. Does it make sense? So when Paul says that singleness is a gift, he's not saying that sex and marriage are bad. He is saying that single people have the gift of time. They have the energy and the flexibility to dedicate their lives to God's mission and expanding God's kingdom. Mm-hmm. Maybe not like through procreation, through children, but through being part of God's mission and leading more people to Him by helping them restore their relationship with the Father. Mm-hmm. Related to this, someone said, what if I want to be single?
Yeah. Well, Paul said it is good, so go for it. No, I heard someone say this before. You know, if you're single, think of yourself as a sports car. You know, you can go fast and you can zip, zip, zip. You can make quick turns and you can make life decisions that are radical, that are immediate. You can make those decisions a lot faster. You have tremendous flexibility, right? If you're married, you have a family, especially, you have a lot more things to think about. It's like an 18-wheeler that takes, you know, five blocks to make a left turn. So you have to get consensus from different people. What do you think about this? What do you think about that? Where are the kids gonna go to school? You know, so you're not as flexible. I mean, I love my family. I would not change a thing. But if you're single, you do have that flexibility. So while you're single now or single, you know, even in the future, use that time and take advantage of that flexibility and zip around for the Lord.
That's a good way, zip around for the Lord. Never heard that before.
Yeah.
You have a...
Oh, next question. Okay, so related to being single also, how does God reveal to a person that he or she is meant for single blessedness?
I like how the questioners called it single blessedness, right? Well, if you're single, that's a pretty good sign that you might, that maybe you're called for that. So yeah, if you are single, maybe that's a sign. Now, if you are single and you're questioning, you know, I've just been eligible and I'm looking, you know, I often say this. I was at a Christian high school, Wisconsin Academy, several months ago, and I was sharing with some young people, and this young person came to me and said, I appreciate how you didn't tell us teenagers not to date. And what I shared with the teenagers was this. I said, they were all asking about dating and relationships. And I said, a lot of us, you know, we have a list A, B, C, 1, 2, 3 of exactly what we want in that future spouse. The question is not, how can I get someone who has those qualities? The question is, do you actually have those qualities? Do I actually have those qualities? Because as one of your friend's dad said, sharks attract sharks.
That's right.
Right? So if you want a nice fish? That's not a shark.
A clownfish.
Is that a nice one? Let's say a dolphin.
A dolphin, yes. There you go.
If you want a dolphin, but you're a shark, you're not going to attract dolphins. You're going to attract sharks, right? So work on being a dolphin first, and maybe you'll attract dolphins, right? Mm-hmm. But if God is calling you to be single, if you look at the top two single characters in the Bible, who were they? Paul the apostle and Jesus. Were they worried about, I'm the most eligible bachelor. Am I going to find someone? No. They were so laser focused and consumed by the gospel and expanding God's mission that was their purpose of life, and they were content with life. So if you are called to singleness, don't fret. Be about God's mission like Paul and Jesus. Mm-hmm. So here's another question. This is a funny one. Should I date a godly girl I do not find attractive?
What do you guys think? I think it's important to date someone you're physically attracted to, right?
Were you attracted to me when you first...
Yes. It grows.
There was some
time.
Hesitancy in that, yes.
But here's the thing. The physical attraction, I think, should not be primary, right? You have to be attracted to the whole person. You have to be attracted to who that person is, who they're becoming in Christ. And so the character attraction, I think, should be primary than the physical attraction. It is important to marry someone you're physically attracted to, of course. But if that is the main attraction, then you know, as years go by, beauty fades, right? But if the character attraction is primary and the physical attraction takes a back seat, you'll find that that physical attraction can grow. Have you ever spent some time who's like beautiful on the inside, who's very nice, and you spend more time with that person and that person just becomes more beautiful to you? Like you just want to spend time with them. And I think that's what happens if you're attracted to who the person really is on the inside. The physical attraction grows as years go by, even though you don't become physically more and more beautiful.
Related to this, so when Katherine and I were hanging out in Madison, Wisconsin. She was at the University of Wisconsin in Madison. Mm-hmm. First time living in the U.S., you chose Wisconsin of all places, coming from Indonesia.
Of all places, yes.
But you were there. We hung out as friends. And it wasn't until, like, I don't know, probably a year and a half in, that I started to think, hey, what if we took this to the next level, right? Mm-hmm. But I was already physically attracted to her, right? But you know what the clincher was for me? You want to meet someone, and we're not talking about dating. And, you know, we'll cover that in September 24 when we talk about dating and courting, okay? So just stay tuned for the second part of our series, Relationship Status. But I had Katherine and two other friends share at church just what it means to be a disciple, right? Mm-hmm. And when Katherine started to speak, my friend Jared, who was single at the time and now he's married, God didn't give him the gift of singleness, he was sitting in the front, he looked back at me, and I knew what he was saying with his eyes. He said, "Nestor, you better move on this one." Why? Because it wasn't just her physical beauty, it was the spiritual beauty. It wasn't the charm of her looks or the charm that she has, and she is charming. It was the character that undergirded that charm, which is what I was attracted to. And so, yeah, like you said, I mean, yeah, physical is important, but, you know, character surpasses charm. All right, question for you. Okay. Has Facebook and social media ruined dating? Did it make it better or worse?
I think both. It can make it better in terms of you can connect with people you wouldn't have connected with otherwise. You're connected to so many different people in different parts of the world. It's worse because of comparison that could happen. You know, you see on social media, someone's boyfriend, husband, or whatever did something special to them, for example. I don't know, send a large bouquet of roses, whatever it is. And then you think, how come my husband doesn't do that? How come my boyfriend doesn't do that? And so it's comparison, right? Because people display good things on social media, of course. So you can start to compare yourself to other people. I think that's not healthy. But I do think it helps connect us to a larger group of people.
It's like water, right? Water can be either used to harm people, mm-hmm. like drowning, or it can be used to quench your thirst. It's how you use it.
Depending on how you use it.
Okay. Good
question. So, how do I know if they are the one?
Ooh.
This question always comes up when we talk about relationships.
How
right?
do I know that if they are the one? First of all, I just want to disabuse us of this like magical, mysterious sense that I will finally find out that they are the one. Like, I don't believe. I mean, I don't think Scripture even displays that, right? I mean, it talks about that. Like, there's going to be this magic, like, vision, right? And you know, mm-hmm. I think what's more important than that moment of, are they the one? What's more important is, do we have synergy? Are our values and our beliefs and our tastes, and not all preference, but most preferences, are they in line? I think that's what's most important. Katherine and I mean, I know some people have gone much shorter, some have gone longer, but we dated our time of dating to our end of our engagement, which was 3.5 years. Mm-hmm. So we dated for about 3.5 years. And it was as I spent time with Katherine, and as we were continuing to do ministry together and laughing together and do life together with friends, as we were experiencing that synergy, it was in that synergy that I realized that this was the one for me. So more important than that aha moment where, you know, you get this epiphany like, yeah, this is the one. The question is, do you have synergy with your values and your beliefs and your preferences and your dreams and your life? Mm-hmm.
And you might have different answer to this, right? But for me, what was important was that person is able to keep learning and keep growing, that they're able to just learn from life's experiences, because sometimes we think we're there, right? And marriage is not the goal. After you're married, there's still a lot of growing up to be done.
It's true.
We grow together. And so to see him wanting to keep learning and grow, and also him not afraid to say when his... Wow, Siri thinks I'm talking to her. No, but he also was not afraid to admit that he's wrong. which shows me humility. And so that those were important characteristics for me. And also, I just know that he's the one I want to problem solve with together. I know that sounds so romantic, but in life, you'll get, you know, troubles and challenges in life, and you have to find someone that you want to go through those times with, not just the happy times.
Good answer. Good answer.
All right. So what? Someone asked, what is a good age to get married? What do you think?
All right, you guys ready for this? Take notes. The best age to get married is ages 25 and 30. Okay?
Because that's when we got married.
I'm being funny. I know people that have gotten married and when they were like 16, 17, 18, and they're like, they've been married for 60 years. That's like, wow. Are you, like, most of your life you've been with this person. I know people who get married later in life. I don't think that there's a perfect age for marriage.
Right.
The question is, any age works. The question, it's not so much, am I at the right age? The question is, am I mature? That's the real question. Mm-hmm. Anything else that you wanted to add to that?
No, that's it.
All right. Now, we're getting into some deeper topics here.
Yeah.
So put your seatbelts on.
There are several questions about this topic, so I'll read several of them together. Should Christians date if they disagree theologically? Is that being unequally yoked? Should I date someone who is not a Christian or who is far from God right now? And will it be really possible for a romantic relationship to work if your partner has a different belief or religion?
So those are three questions, and I'm going to try to give a response here. So first of all, in the beginning of that question, is that what is being unequally yoked? So this comes from 2 Corinthians 6:14. This is Paul speaking. Do not be yoked together with unbelievers. Now, what in the world is being yoked? It's not talking about egg yolks. a yoke was that the tool and device. Let's just say this is the yoke, right? That would we put it back here. It was the plow that that would be tied to two oxen, and as long as the two oxen are aligned and working together, then the plow will be able to plow. So that's what he means by being yoked. So he's saying, don't be yoked together with unbelievers. Okay? So this is not specifically speaking about Christian denominations. Because at that point there was only one Christian denomination. There was only Christianity and everything else. Okay? So he's saying, excuse me, do not be yoked together with non-Christians. That's what Paul's saying. For what do righteousness and wickedness have in common? Or what fellowship can light have with darkness? And so what Paul is saying is that if you're a believer, don't pursue a relationship with a non-believer. Because you have differences of value. You have differences of preferences, differences of taste, differences of belief system. And really, fundamentally, like, God is not trying to limit our happiness. He's actually trying to elevate our happiness. Because he knows that when we work together, when we have synergy, that there's the most joy, right? He's speaking specifically here about non-believers. Now, the question, someone else asked a question, or the same person asked, will it really be possible to have a romantic relationship if your partner has a different belief, or even maybe they're of a Christian denomination? I mean, you can still have romance, right? We're designed to love and to be in love, but to have it work, I mean, the best way for it to work, I mean, the ideal way where you can have the most synergy is when your values are aligned.
Yeah.
Anything else you wanted to say?
Yeah, I think what usually ends up happening when you're with a non-Christian, right, a non-believer, is one of two things. The first is God gets pushed to the sideline. Not intentionally, right, but just by the nature of your relationship, because God is not the common interest that you both have, God ends up being pushed to the sideline. And so either that or the spouse gets pushed to the sideline. God remains being the center of your life, but, you know, your spouse just becomes that person you can't really connect with in a spiritual level. So then you're stuck, right? If 9 times out of 10, when you're making a major decision in your life, you think about God and what He thinks, so that means that when we make a major decision in our life, I have to hide the most important thing in my life, which is God. And you don't want that. You don't want to hide the most important thing in your life. And like he said, the synergy will happen if you're able to connect, you know, physically, emotionally, spiritually. So synergy will happen if you connect in one of those levels. Can the relationship work? Sure, I think it can. You can have an okay relationship. But if you're a young person and you're asking this question and you're not married yet, I want you to have the best relationship possible. And if you want that synergy, I think it's better to stick with a believer. And a marriage is hard enough with two believers in it. You have a lot of troubles that you're gonna face together. So if you throw in a non-believer to the mix, you'll have another set of issues to deal with. That's what I would say.
Good, I love it. Good answer.
So then what if you go to these churches and then you find no one? You want to be with someone, but you find no one.
Okay, let's just be real here, okay? So I grew up in the city of Chicago, and like your best window, especially if you're a collegiate young adult, your best window is college, especially if you go to like a Christian Adventist college. And by God's grace, I missed that window, and I met Katherine in my first pastorate. And so let me tell you this. So you want to expose yourself if you're single, ready to mingle. And by the way, on September 17, we're going to talk about singleness. Okay, that's our first topic, singleness on September 17. If you're single, put yourself in environments where you can find someone who has similar values. So church, if there's nothing here, we need to talk to Pastor Mike Campos. He's a member here and the youth director of the Illinois Conference. You need to have more young adult events, right? Especially for singles, right? So put yourself in opportunities, environments where you can meet other singles who have the same mind. Go to youth conferences. And then still, if you still haven't found someone, just trust the Lord and He'll provide at His time. I mean, I didn't get married until I was 30 years old, and I knew for a fact, I mean, not because, just because I'm a pastor, I mean, my values are like, they're like deeply embedded in my heart, mm-hmm. and that's not going to shake, and I knew exactly what I wanted. I wanted someone who has the same belief system, because I want the most synergy as much as possible, and so I waited, and God introduced me to someone that grew up almost halfway across the world in Jakarta, Indonesia, and went to school in Wisconsin, and my first pastorate was in Wisconsin, and lo and behold, we've been married 9 years, and we have 2 beautiful kids. So just trust the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding.
Amen.
And He will provide that special someone for you.
Yeah.
Let's go to the next one, because the time is running out.
Okay.
Here.
So, the next one, it's kind of a heavier question, so when we read it, it kind of broke our heart a little bit. But I do want to affirm whoever submitted this question. Thank you for having the courage to share your story and to submit the question, because I think it helps other people who are struggling with the same thing. So the question is, how does God view inconsistent, lying husbands to wives? What cues does God give me to remove myself from a husband who is degrading and violent?
So I looked at all the questions in our question database, and when I read this one, this was the most painful one that I read. Mm-hmm. And so just like Katherine said, I don't know who wrote this, but first of all, I want to affirm your courage. And your willingness to even ask this question, okay? And just know that we're here for you. So I do want to share 2 things. How does God view these kind of people? What cues does God give me to remove myself? What's awesome about the image of God is that there's perfect synergy, and they also help and lift each other up. And if there is, if you're in a situation where you're not safe, where that synergy, that there's dysfunction, especially like physical abuse, Paul says, you may need to separate for some time, but you have to really put your safety and your children's safety top priority. I mean, you can't live and thrive if you're not safe. So number one, protect yourself. And then number two, get help. So we can help. I mean, speak to me, speak to the pastoral team, speak to Katherine. Speak to someone you trust in the church. I think what's scary about our culture, especially church culture at large, is that we're not willing to ask these tough questions. And when we don't ask the tough questions, we end up struggling. So I want to affirm you for asking this tough question. And so if you're willing to ask that tough question, then we are willing to come alongside you in your journey and to help you. Mm-hmm. And if you need counseling, we can find some connections. We want to do everything that we can to help you.
Yeah.
So protect yourself and get help. Now, question from that same person, how can I show my children that I honor God when I feel degraded by my husband?
That's a tough question. I think part of honoring God is also honoring yourself, right? Because God said, he's your creator, and he said to love your neighbors as yourself. So you do have to love yourself. You do have to love yourself enough to put up boundaries. It is possible to love someone and still put up boundaries. You can't treat me this way. I want to talk to you, but I can't talk to you if you decide to treat me that way. Let's talk when you're calm. Let's talk when you can treat me well. You know, there's that book, Boundaries. I don't know if you guys have heard it. It's an awesome book, Boundaries, by Henry Cloud and John Thompson. Mm-hmm. That's a great book to read. But yeah, I do want to say, you can show your children that you honor God by also honoring yourself. So you can love your husband and still have the self-value. You can show your children that. Like, I also need to be respected. I need to be valued. And I think your children will see that and see a woman of greatness when they see that.
Real quick, to that husband, if he is listening, and I'm not pointing the finger, I'm looking at myself too, because I'm proud, and if it weren't for Jesus, I would lose control. So there's this vision that true strength, brute strength, is violence, but that's not strength. That's cowardice. That's cowardice. So I don't know. That's cowardice. The bully that bullies you, they think that they're strong. That's cowardice. True strength is not violence. True strength is humility. Amen. It's Jesus saying, I'm going to get down on my knee, disciples, and I'm going to serve you and wash your feet. That's the picture of what strength is. Strength is not violence and aggression. Strength is humility. I could say more, but I'll stop there. Strength is humility.
Okay. Next question. So if someone did some bad things toward you, how can you forgive that person if that person has already died? How can you recover from the pain, suffering, and traumas you've experienced a long time ago? That's heavy.
Yes, this is heavy. We're landing this plane. These are the last group of questions. Mm-hmm. So if someone did some bad things towards you, how can you forgive that person if that person has already died? Let me just share that the person doesn't have to be present or even alive for you to be able to forgive that person. Mm-hmm. Okay? They don't have to be there. You can still forgive that individual, even if that person has passed away. How can you recover from the pain and the trauma that you've experienced? Let me go to Ephesians chapter 4, I was just reading this with some friends this week. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 29. Okay, so how can you recover? Okay, this is how I can recover from trauma. Ephesians 4, 29. Do not let any unwholesome talk come out of your mouths, but only what is helpful for building others up according to their needs, that it may benefit those who listen. So it's easy for us to let unwholesome talk come out of our mouths to people that for perpetrators and people that have harmed us. Verse 30, and do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, meaning that I can bring sorrow to God if I continue an unwholesome talk, with whom you were sealed for the day of redemption. I still think that there's a time for us to speak up and to say that something is wrong. But I think what Paul is saying, be careful. Verse 31, get rid of all bitterness, rage, anger, brawling, slander, along with every form of malice. Be kind and compassionate to one another. Mm-hmm. So he's saying, get rid of that, but be kind and compassionate. Why? How so? By forgiving each other, just as in Christ God forgave you. So how can we recover? First of all, like, recovery is not at the blink of an eye. It's not the snap of a finger. Mm-hmm. Recovering from trauma takes a long time, sometimes years, sometimes even decades. But we can still forgive people even when we're in the process of healing. Mm. Like, forgiveness is not synonymous with healing. Mm. Forgiveness begins the healing process, but it's not synonymous. And so the only way that I can forgive someone that has harmed me is to look at what Jesus did, because he forgave me when I harmed him. Even though I rejected God, Jesus said, I'm going to die for you anyway. And because of his great love for me and dying for me and forgiving me, even when I don't deserve it, it gives me the capacity to not only know what love and forgiveness looks like when someone doesn't deserve it, but it also gives me the experience of love. I was thinking about the Lord's Prayer when I was reciting it this morning. Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Some versions say, forgive us our transgressions as we forgive those who transgressed against us. A transgression that someone has done to you becomes a debt. And we feel like that person owes me, that person is in debt to me. And what Jesus does for me is that he's canceled all my debt, and he gives me a vision, an experience of mercy. And so since I experience mercy, then somehow, in some way, by the miracle of God and the grace of God, I can extend that same mercy to the person that has hurt me. Mm-hmm. It's easier said than done. Mm-hmm. Much easier said than done. But only through Jesus and what he's done for us, through the gospel, is it possible.
Mm-hmm. And when we talk about pain, suffering, and trauma, I think it's easier to forgive someone who feels repentant, right? If they know that they're doing something wrong to you, you can forgive them easier, right? Even though it's still hard. But what's harder is, what if that person who has wronged you doesn't really believe that they have done anything wrong? Is not repentant. That is so hard. What if they choose, you know, selective listening or selective memory? They think, oh, you're just trying to destroy my name, destroy my image. You know, whatever that case is, and I don't know what you're going through here, whoever submitted this question, but we don't have to be in the presence of, you know, the abuser in order to forgive them. We can still forgive them in our hearts. Forgiveness is God's to give. And so we can still experience that forgiveness even when we don't confront that person. Hmm. There are some cases when you confront the person and you might be even more in pain.
Triggered.
Yes, you'll be triggered and you'll be more painful. You come out of that conversation and you're more in pain. And so I think we can still forgive that person even if we're not, like, face-to-face with them. And so, how do we heal? Yeah, it takes a long time, and I think sometimes we think we can heal if we just let time goes on, but I think we also need to heal, like, on purpose. We need to get help. We need to go out there and be willing to be healed. I think sometimes it might get worse before it gets better, but the pain is necessary, I think, to heal.
As you were talking, I was thinking, time lessens the pain, but only Jesus heals the pain.
Yeah, yeah.
That's what I thought about when you were talking.
Yeah. And so last question. So how can you forgive someone who wronged you if you can't forgive yourself and you blame yourself that it happened?
So how can you forgive someone who wronged you if you can't even forgive that person and you blame yourself? So I don't know, whoever asked this question, I don't know what you're going through. I don't know if, you know, sometimes it takes two to tango for there to be fire. And sometimes there is an abuser who takes advantage of a victim. I don't know. But let me just speak to that blame, that feeling of blame. I thought, you know, last night I was thinking about this. If there was anyone who was going to blame themselves and throw a pity party, it was Adam and Eve. Mm. Adam and Eve were given the garden. They were perfect. They were made in the image of God, and they lived this perfect life. But they were seduced by an abuser. His name was Satan. But they chose, right? And so I was trying to think about and experience the pain that Adam and Eve experienced when they were blaming themselves. Like, I can't believe we just did this. I can't believe we just brought sin. You know, I believe that when Adam saw the first leaf fall, he cried. Like, they had not seen death. Mm. And so if anyone was throwing a pity party and blaming themselves, it was Adam and Eve. And they were naked and unashamed when they had God's glory, but once they sinned, they lost God's glory, they were naked, and they were ashamed. And you know, I'm going to share, this is my last verse as we wrap this up. You know what the text says in Genesis 3:21? Genesis chapter 3:21 says when they were ashamed, the Lord God made garments of skin for Adam and his wife and clothed them. So they were ashamed, they were blaming themselves, they were naked because they lost the glory of God. But God didn't give up on them. He said, I'm going to clothe you with skin. I'm going to clothe you with skin from an animal. And the question is, where did that come from? It had to come from an animal that died for them, that was able to cover them with clothing again. And could it be that this was a picture of what God would do in rescuing us by sending the animal, our God, the Lamb of God, Jesus, to die for us so that when we experience the worst blame and pity in the world, that he comes alongside and he says, you know what? I'm going to provide my garments to cover you, my righteousness to clothe you, so that you don't have to blame yourself and live in that self-pity for anymore. Mm. And so I believe that we can experience the forgiveness, the strength to forgive others, but also through Jesus, the ability to forgive ourselves when we're blaming ourselves. And that's only through what Jesus has done for us on the cross of Calvary, by receiving what he has done for us.
Amen.
So as the praise team comes up, I do want to share this. If you have more questions, fill out that QR code. But also, we have a connect card here. And you want to get connected, you have more questions, maybe on the back here, the connect card in the pew in front of you, or we even have the connect card online. Maybe you have a special prayer request and you're struggling. Friend, we want to hear from you. We'll get in touch with you. If you just want to say, look, I don't want to just expose myself. I just want to say, I want to talk to a pastor. Just say, I want to talk to a pastor. Leave your best contact. We want to come alongside you and connect with you and to help you. Friends, let's come together. Let's sing together. And we're going to sing this song, Lord, I Need You, because we really need Jesus, and especially in times like these.
I come, I confess.
Says in Genesis 3:21, the Lord God made garments of skin for Adam and his wife and clothed them. Thank you, Lord, that in everything that we experience in life, the shame, the blame, the pain, we thank you that you sent Jesus to save us, to clothe us with his righteousness, with his joy, with his peace. And so I pray that that peace will come upon each person here, and that before we even think about others, that we would think about ourselves first, that we would find synergy in a relationship with you. We love you, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. Friends, you've been blessed by the word today. Go out, be the church in this community. God bless you.
My song to rise to you when temptation comes my way, when I cannot stand, I'll fall on you. Jesus, you're my hope and stay. So teach my song to rise to you. Temptation comes my way. When I cannot stand, I fall on you. Jesus, you're my